what I was going to do, I was going to talk about some a strategy for working with data that works with analytics data, but work with other flavors of data. I've styled it conversations with data, and I'll explore a little bit about what that means and some of my attitudes towards data and how we can actually work with it. Now, I see this in part as recognizing and addressing a skills gap. And this is a skills gap associated with the skills that people need in order to be able to work with data effectively. For most people who use data, the environment they do so is likely to be a spreadsheet, an Excel spreadsheet typically. This is not necessarily the best sort of tool to work with data, although it is one of the most general. And I think one of the issues we've got to start addressing is getting people up to a skills level where they can start to work with powerful data tools, data analysis tools, data visualization tools, and data wrangling tools, so that they can make the most of the data that they've got to work with. Now, I came across a quote a couple of days ago from John Tukey, a statistician from several decades ago, right at the start of computer use within statistics and within visualizations. And Tukey came up with the notions of exploratory data analytics. And writing in 1965, so 50 years ago now, at the dawn of computing in statistics, he said that one of the things that computers would allow people to do is become journeyman carpenters of data analytical tools, by which I think he had the attitude that people would be able to start developing their own tools and working with their own fashion tools to work with the data sets. And these tools will be fashioned using computers, computer software and computer hardware. Now, as George mentioned, I like playing with things. I quite like getting my hands dirty with data and with data wrangling tools. And I'm not going to talk so much about the details or specifics in this presentation, although on my blog, Useful Info, you can find many recipes and examples of how I work with tools. So in this talk, I'm going to focus a little bit more on my attitude towards data analysis and the tools that we have available to us. And again, quoting from Tukey, he sees exploratory data analysis as an attitude, a flexibility to work with tools and to work with data, an emphasis on using visualizations to actually look at data sets, not just run statistical, mathematical statistics, but also run visual statistics. And visualization plays a large part in the approach that I take to working with data. So one final quote, and this one will give anyone listening or viewing a bit of channel conflict as you try to read this quote while I also talk over it. This comes from Lee Wilkinson, who developed an approach of using graphics called the grammar of graphics. And he was writing in this book in 1999 about the tools that we have available to us, and his attitude, like Tukey's, that we shouldn't be afraid to give users powerful tools, even if they aren't necessarily well-versed in statistics. There are lots of tools out there, powerful tools. This tool that I'm using tonight, presentation tools, is a powerful tool. It can be used badly, can be used well, but these powerful tools we should all have available to us, and we should all make the most of them. So I'm going to show you some powerful tools that I think we should make available to anyone who wants to work with data, rather than just encouraging them to stick with a general purpose tool such as Google Sheets or Microsoft Excel. So when working with data at a high level, I see two sorts of issues, and this works at a very general level, and we can apply this distinction going down to quite fine detailed problems as well. On the one hand, we've got issues of data accessibility. So at the top level, this means just how to get hold of data. There are lots of data sets out there. They're increasingly becoming available in the open data world, where I spend a lot of my time. But in institutions and organizations, lots of data sets are available. Although the format in which the data is made available may not be so easy for people to make use of. On the other hand, we've got issues of making sense of data, so data sense making. This is analyzing the data, finding stories in the data, and telling stories from data sets. If we slice across those, we've got four steps or four stages whenever we're working with a data set. Cleaning data sets, so making data sets, taking data sets that we've found or discovered, getting them into a state where we can actually start working with them. Shaping data sets, which refers to getting the data into a physical shape where we can start to analyze it and ask questions using the tools that we have available to us. Augmenting data, which I'm not going to talk about so much today, but that relates to linking two or more data sets together. So we're taking different data sets and then merging them on common columns or column features. And finally, looking at data, the ways in which we can actually visually explore a data set to try to learn something from it. Now, this may involve going back and cleaning the data more, or more likely, it will involve reshaping the data and augmenting the data so we can get a better look at it. And I'll cover most of those, all the cleaning, shaping, and looking within this presentation. So, if we're going to clean data, that implies that we've got dirty data. So, dirty data is data, well, dirty data, data that comes in a variety of forms, real forms, that make it difficult to work with. So, I've given some examples on that slide there. Dates are a big problem whenever you're working with a data set, particularly a data set you've found. The same date can be represented in multiple ways, particularly within spreadsheets where a column is used as a set of characters rather than an actual date. So the 10th of March 2014 might be represented as 3 minus 10, 14, or it might be represented as 10/3/14. These different statements all refer to the same date, but a computer doesn't know that necessarily. If we're trying to search for a date or do datey things with that data, US gun policy. Tweet from George there. So we have different data represented in different ways that actually means the same thing. And one of the stages we would go through in cleaning a data set would be putting dates into date formats so that we are actually talking about a date as a datey thing, where the computer knows that it is this particular point in time rather than a set of characters. We also get numbers. Numbers are numbers in spreadsheets. When numbers are numbers in spreadsheets, we can add them up, take them away, do sums with them. When numbers are presented in a form that's more intelligible to us, so that example on the screen, an amount of just over £1 billion pounds, we've got a pound sign getting in the way, we've got a comma getting in the way, and we've got a magnitude amount, million, getting in the way. That isn't a number that a computer would recognize, although we could start to build parsers that could read it as such. But that's the sort of data that we get in a lot of data sets, numbers that are represented as other things. And when we're cleaning a data set, we've got to bring to various tools to bear to help us get these messy strings into things that are actually numbers where we can start doing sums with them. We also get lots of missing characters, and there's different sorts of missing data. Data might be missing because it doesn't exist. It might be missing because we don't have access to it. Missing data can be represented in different ways in different systems. And whenever we're working with a data set, we have to, first of all, identify those data elements that might be missing, and then work out what sort of missing they might mean, because there are different sorts of missing. Sometimes it may or may not be clear whether or not we've got a data point that's missing because we haven't got access to it, or it's missing because it doesn't exist. Part of the issue with cleaning dirty data is that we don't necessarily have access to the person who originated that data, and this can further add to our issues when trying to make sense of it. So one of the tools that I use for trying to tidy up data sets, or tabular data sets in particular, is a tool called OpenRefine. This can be downloaded from openrefine.org. It runs across platforms. It runs as a service that you access through a web browser. And what it allows you to do is work with a single tabular data set and do a variety of row and column-based operations on it. So it's particularly good at column-based operations. I've given an example on the screen there which shows the opening page of OpenRefine, and it shows that you can load in a wide variety of data formats into this tool. So we can load in CSV files, we can load in Excel files in a variety of formats, we can load in XML files as well. RDF files are data that come from linked data sources, typically. And we could also load in JSON files. So this is JavaScript object notation data, data that's made available through a wide variety of APIs. So we can load data into OpenRefine. We can get it into a tabular format where we can start to clean it and process it. And what I'll do now is just show you some of the various tools that, or sub-tools that are offered through OpenRefine. These tools apply down a column, so we can load data sets into OpenRefine of several hundred thousand rows. It happily works with, depending on the speed of your computer. And we can apply different operations down a column or across multiple columns. So faceting tools provide ways of looking at different facets of the data. In a categorical data column, so a column where we've got the names of different things, so it might be the names of individuals or the names of companies, for example, we can take a text facet which will pull out all the unique names, all the unique values down that column. So this can be a really handy tool for looking at generate text facets across multiple columns, which will give us the unique values for each of those different columns, and then we can filter our data set according to values we've selected through those text facets. So many of you will be familiar with the idea of facets from Amazon shopping, where you've got facets for different categories of goods, so it might be books or films. We've got different categories in a separate faceted area, which might be the different genres of book or film title. And we can filter selectively within those different facets. Similarly, within OpenRefine, we can use different facets to filter down into our data sets. We can edit cells on a row basis, so we can apply transformations to each cell within a column, one cell at a time. So several common transforms are made available just by default within the tool, so we can trim white space at the start or end of a cell. We can change the case within different within the cell elements. We convert things that are strings to numbers. We can convert things that are strings or numbers to dates. We can convert things to text. So we can make different type transformations to each cell within a column. And we can also apply our own transformations as well by writing a simple one line of Python code or the Google Refine Expression Language, GREL code. We can apply transformations, programming-based transformations, on a per-cell basis down a column. We can also fill all the cells. If we've got blanks going down a column, we've got a row in a cell, then a series of blanks below it, we can fill that value down to fill in blanks. Or we can just blank out a cell completely. We can also split cells that have got multiple values in them. So if we've got a comma-separated list of values within a column, we can separate out each of those comma-separated items into separate columns, which can be useful. And we can also join cells together. At the bottom of that list, there's a tool called Cluster and Edit, and this is a really handy set of tools for working with data sets. When we've got values, names of something in particular down a column, if this data has been entered manually by a person, it's quite likely that they will have entered words relating to the same name, the same person, the same company, the same thing, in slightly different ways. So this example here is a set of data from an exploration we did on the manufacture of garments in Bangladesh. We were looking at companies who were running the factories that produce these garments. And we see here lists of names of companies that are sort of similar. So at the top, AKH Stitch Art Limited, two different versions there. The LTD at the end is represented differently. If we were doing an exact search on these company names, if the search was case sensitive, then we might miss some of those items. So those are cell edits we can apply. We can also do operations to columns themselves, so we can rename or move columns. We can add columns to the data set by fetching URLs. So this can be quite a handy way of annotating your data or extending your data. If you've got a list of URLs in this data set, we can use those URLs to go and fetch HTML pages or data from APIs into additional columns within the tool. We can also construct URLs based around cell contents, so to pull data in from online data services. So if we've got an online data service that takes in or that accepts the name of a company, for example, and returns a set of company information, we can construct a URL that calls that API from the values contained within a column, generate the URLs, go off and get the data, and then put that into additional cells within this data set. We can transpose data within the tool, and we can reconcile data. Reconciliation is a linked data technique, so a semantic web linked data technique, where we can take cell values within a column and we can look them up on the web and we can pull back additional information about them. Now, when working with data sets, the shape of data often influences to a very great extent what we can actually do with a data set. The slide hasn't rendered properly here. This is a shame. The top blank cell there should have an example of a data set where we've got rows of data that are in what is called a wide format. The data set that I've used as an example actually is examples of Formula One race results. And in this top cell at the top, where the image hasn't converted properly, we should have a wide data format where we have the name of a driver and then we have the different columns for different races. So we'd have a column for the race results for a race in Australia, a column for the race results in Bahrain, a column for the race results in Malaysia, and so on. So that's a wide data format. And lots of data sets are published in a wide format. It can be hard to work with. So as an example of reshaping the data set, we can do a transformation that's known as a melt operation. This is a melt done using the R programming language, which takes these separate columns and melts them and puts them into rows. So in the original data set, I would have had a column for results in Australia by the name of the driver, a column for results in Bahrain, a column for results in Malaysia. By melting the data, we can pull all those separate columns down into a single column that identifies the race, which would have been the original column name, and then the value from each of those columns applied along the row. So when the data is in this longer form, it quite often becomes easier to work with, particularly when generating charts. There are other times where we may want the data in the wide format, and again we can do a reverse operation where we would take this melted data, we could go down the race column and we could say for each unique value in this column I want to generate a column and then put in the associated position value. So we can transform the shape of data sets very flexibly using powerful tools, using computational tools, by writing down the transformations we want. So in my original wide data set, I took the drivers as the key and melted all the other data sets. By transforming the data, we get data that we can use differently. Now this data set, when I see a data set that looks like that, a column of values, column of values, I actually see that as a hierarchical data set. I know through familiarization of working with data sets, as do many people who work with data sets, that we can represent this data in a hierarchical format. And a good tool, a visual tool for doing that, is a tree map. So this is a tree map of medal awards in the Olympics. And this top left tree map, the top level, the big outer square, is the allocation of gold medals. Within each of those is a separate area of the tree map that shows the allocation of medals by country. So this was the allocation of medals to China, then we have the allocation of medals below it to gold medals to the USA, and then in the middle the allocation of gold medals to Korea. Within each country grouping there is a further breakdown of the number of goals that was awarded to each particular country within a particular sport. So badminton, weightlifting, and diving were good gold medal hauls for China. The USA got a large number of medals for swimming and cycling and rowing. The size of the squares is related to the number of medals that the country got in each of those disciplines, and the colour is not a very useful colour, but we could also use that to indicate the number of gold medals either in this Olympics or perhaps the previous Olympics, so we could show the difference in number, whether or not the medal haul was increased or decreased from the previous Olympics by colour. The same data set, exactly the same medal data set, was used to generate the other tree map, the one at the bottom right. And in this case, we've got the country as the top level, and then within it, we've got the different disciplines. So here, in the top left of this second chart, the swimming discipline, we can see the medal haul for the USA, the medal haul for China, the medal haul for Australia. And we see that the USA won most of the medals in swimming. These medal tables actually are broken down into three sections, each of those medals, the medals awarded for gold, silver, or bronze. So at a glance, within a particular discipline, we can see relatively how many medals were awarded across the different disciplines. Then within a discipline, we can see the country that got the largest medal haul. And then within each country, we can see the breakdown of the number of medals they got for gold, silver, or bronze. So these hierarchical data sets, the same data set generated both of those visualizations, simply by rearranging the order in which we take the columns and we map them onto different hierarchical layers of the tree. And one of the things that being able to work with data tools in a programmatic way means that we can quite easily write descriptions for these charts and generate them. And I'll give some examples of how to do that in a few slides' time. Now, these tree maps, there is a tool called ManyEyes, which is an old IBM tool available online, that allows you to generate tree maps. And through just changing the order of columns, it will generate different views of the tree maps, such as these two different views here. This sort of dynamic is one that's replicated and is very similar to the use of pivot tables and interactive pivot tables in many spreadsheet and data analysis tools. And a pivot table tool that I've started exploring a lot quite lately comes from Nicholas Crutchton. It's a JavaScript tool which provides an interactive pivot table. You load in a data set, a simple from a CSV file it could be, and it generates this interactive widget for you with the names of the columns provided along the top by default. But not every chart will give you all the answers to the big questions you've got. Again, quoting Tukey, there's no more reason to expect one graph to tell all than to expect one number to do the same. So a number there might be a summary statistic. In many cases, we want to use a wide variety of visualization tools or techniques in order to get different views over a data set, in order to understand different things from it. So when we're looking at hierarchical data, for example, using a tree map, there may be different ways that we can take the same data and look at it in different ways to understand different things about it. So this is a representation of a data set that we could display as a tree map. But here, we've got a set of quantities that are conserved, which is, I'm using Formula One sports data again, which is points allocation. And in Formula One, points are awarded to drivers based on their performance within a particular Grand Prix race. And the points that a driver earns are also aggregated by the team the driver drives for. So the points are conserved. And where we have quantities that can conserved, and we can often think about them in terms of quantities that flow around a circuit. So this diagram is a sort of diagram referred to as a Sankey diagram, and originally developed for mapping energy flows. So these diagrams show how things flow. In the OU, one of the things we've been looking at is how students might progress through different courses. So different courses at different levels within a course. So they might take different modules within the first year, different modules within the second year, different modules within the third year. We could use a Sankey diagram there. We've got student numbers either flowing through courses or dropping out. We could use Sankey diagrams to represent the flow of populations across the different courses. So again, these visual tools, different visual tools, allow you to explore different sorts of properties. So tree maps allow us to explore hierarchical data sets, rearranging the hierarchies on the fly. Tools like Sankey Diagrams allow us to look at the same sorts of data. We can arrange this data in a hierarchical form, but as a form of flow to see how things flow from one level to another level. And as we look at these different flows, we see different stories. So here, this is just carbon dioxide, methane, so gas production on the right-hand side, or gas use. Gas is being used in roads, commercial buildings, so different sorts of facilities, and those facilities are generating their carbon dioxide by different means. So commercial buildings are generating it from electricity and heat or fuel combustion, and this is all a category of energy contributing to carbon dioxide. These diagrams allow us to tell stories of flow, and being able to put data into these diagrams allow us to read these stories from them. One of the reasons we use images, again quoting Tukey, the picture examining eye is the best finder we have of the wholly unanticipated. When we're looking at data sets as sets of numbers or even summary statistics, quite often a lot of the actual intrigue is hidden within the detail of the data. By expressing the data in a visual form, it allows us to spot patterns and structures more easily. And spot surprising things within the data sets. So what different ways are there of looking at data? Many of us are familiar with typical chart styles we learned from school. So bar charts, column charts, even the dreaded pie chart, which is a badly misused chart. And data tables as well. Data tables are a useful, valid way of looking at data, although they can be hard to make sense of if you've got millions of rows of data. In contrast, a visualization may help you look at a million data points and spot the odd ones out quite quickly. There's a wide variety of tools for generating charts. When the tools for visualizing these charts are interactive tools, it allows us to explore the data in an interactive and dynamic way. So this is a couple of examples of charts using, again, the Many Eyes tool. Here we've got a histogram and a scatter plot, and we can select what the mapping from our data set, what columns go onto which axes, are using drop-down lists, so we can have very quickly look at the same data set in a variety of different views just on the fly. We can search within the data sets for particular data points and highlight them as shown in this top level. And when it comes to looking for outliers, here we've got a distribution of data points. Each block represents a different data point, and we're counting the number of data points that have got particular values. We can very easily see the outliers. We can see an outlier up here. We can see an outlier up down the bottom. So this was actually data from UK MPs expenses data. So this is the values of people claiming centrally purchased stationery. This person was claiming a lot. This person had got a minus £2,000 rebate. So there's questions to be asked about the behaviour of those two people. We can use charts to ask questions of data in a variety of ways. An underestimated and underused way is simply for counting and sorting things. So this chart was taken from a blog post on Cooling for Graphics blog a couple of weeks ago, which is showing sums donated for different causes, looking at the amount of people dying from a particular disease and the amount that was being raised to spend on these diseases, and connecting or using colour to connect different sides of the chart and a line to connect items. So a political decision was taken, an infographic design decision was taken to sort each of these columns according to the biggest at the top and the smallest at the bottom. But that's not necessarily the most powerful way of telling that story. By sorting the columns differently, in this case we've sorted the left column according to the values on the right, we get a completely different way of reading this chart, and a different story immediately jumps out at us, that the relative sizes of the bubbles is far easier to compare. They're easier to compare because the things we're comparing are on the same row. Whereas here, we're trying to make a comparison where things are dislocated in space. So the simple application of sorting in the original design, someone had sorted on both columns the same way, gives a different story and a very different way of just getting an immediate gut reaction, gut response to the reading of this data set to the one we've got on the right-hand side. Just thinking about sorting data, quite often we see bar charts, column charts, in reports and on tables, where the columns are all higgledy-piggledy in a ragged way. But by sorting the data, so that we've got decreasing columns, for example, or increasing columns, or sorting on other dimensions, we may get very, very different readings of the same chart. So the same chart, if we can sort the columns on a column chart or a bar chart, if we can sort the columns in two or three different ways, we may get two or three different charts from the same data set and from the same sort of chart. Simply the act of sorting changes our reading and our interpretation of the data. So when we're looking at data sets and when we're trying to make sense of them, when we're trying to interpret them, what sorts of things can we look for? And I'll just give a few examples of the sorts of things that I look for when I'm trying to explore a data set. We can look for outliers. Often sorting the data in different ways helps you see outliers that arise from different sortings. When we sort, we can find top threes, bottom threes. You know, we can do simple rankings. We can find means and medians and look for the differences between them, which often tell us quite a lot about distributions. So when we're looking for outliers, I'll go back to that, looking for outliers, we can look for outliers on a scatter plot, so the points that lies off at the extreme. In our chart here, we had an outlier at the top and an outlier at the bottom. There are different ways of thinking about how we can generate outliers. This is a set of time series data. Apologies again, this is Formula One sports data, where we've got different rounds that a particular driver was competing in and the position they scored. And what I was trying to look for here was outliers in terms of streaky behavior across different sets of drivers. So rather than an outlier being a single point, what I was trying to do was try to identify streaks where drivers had got were behaving in a particular way. So streaks in which they were placed in the top five. So we've got a streak of two, a streak of one, two, three, four, five, six, a streak of seven, then there was a gap, a streak of two, a streak of five. And one thing that I was interested in was whether or not this streak of seven could in any sense be classed as an outlier. Was it unusual that this driver should get seven wins in a row? That's where we've got to start applying statistics. The point I wanted to make here from this point was that outliers may not be single points. Outliers may be constructed through analyses of looking at things over time. If we're looking at things over time, consecutive sequences, long runs, long streaks may actually be outliers and therefore of interest. And so one of the things we need to do when we're looking at time series data, possibly, is start looking at long run behaviors, sequences where behaviors are taking place in a particular way. In a learning sense, this might be patterns of behavior in test scores. If you've got a set of test scores from particular individuals but are taking regular tests over the course of a term or course of a year, we may well get different streaks in patterns of behavior, and there being able to analyze whether or not one streak is unusual or not could be a useful indicator of whether or not it's an outlier, whether or not it's an interesting point. So as well as looking for outliers, we can look for similarities and differences. This is from a set of data which was financial spending data. And the spending data had got amounts being paid to companies and rebates from them. And what I was trying to look for, I'd noticed within this data, payments and anti-payments, so refunds, being made to different companies. And so this chart, taking the idea of the journeyman carpenter building our own tools, was constructed to try to find items visually where payments had been made and then refunded. So on here I've got little black points and red diamonds, red triangles around them. Red triangles are payments that have been made as refunds on particular days, and the little small black dots are payments that have been made on a particular day. And where we get a red triangle, the red triangle is sized so that it sits over a black dot, we can see points at which we've got a payment made and a refund made of exactly the same amount on the same day. And so we can start to look for similarities and differences within these payments, although here the similarities are between numbers that are positive and negative numbers. So this, a refund was made one amount on the same day. We can also split the data out. So tools allow us to split the data out. This was looking at a complete set of energy payments data set. Same data set had been split into electricity and gas payments. And visually, using a visual tool, it was quite easy to separate out that aggregated set of figures into ones that were electricity payments and ones that were gas payments to see whether or not there was different sorts of behavior between those two charts. So there, that's tunneling down into the same data set as the original one, just by splitting it out into visual facets. Another way of exploring data is to look for trends. Lots of data comes as time series. We quite often look at time series data over a timeline, so we've got a series of dates along the bottom. If we've got a series of dates along the bottom, we can quite often overlay different periods along the same axis. So these are a set of charts where I've got data sets from a particular set of numbers, doesn't particularly matter what, from three different years. The years are coloured with different lines. And I've overlaid the data sets just to try to see whether or not there's similar patterns of behaviour year on year. So if we'd looked at this as a set of a single timeline along the bottom of 1 year, then the second year, then the third year, we'd see up, down, up, down, up, down. Overlaying the data on the same chart, likely up to. We can sense of behavior within months by year. So in this chart, I've got separate columns for each month of the year, and there are different streaks within the months corresponding to different years. And here we can see how the data is acting within a month across years and also across the whole year. So within the month of January, we see a particular trend in behavior. Within February, we see a trend in behavior. Across the year, we see a trend in behavior. And this data set, these big jumps between the patterns of behavior in the middle of each month, suggests that the way this data was being calculated has changed. So the data's been rebased from a set of values down here to a set of values up here. So this was actually, I think, job seekers allowance figures in the Isle of Wight, and there was a recalculation of how those numbers were generated midway through the data set that I've displayed here. Other ways of looking for patterns and structures on maps. Lots of data set makes sense when viewed, centered within just a table, and sorted according to the value of expenses that had been claimed. So someone would look at the data set and say one MP had claimed more than someone else, and therefore, you know, there was something suspicious about that. But when we rebase the data by looking at it geographically, by plotting MPs, how much they claim for travel expenses based on where their constituencies were, we could start to see whether or not they were claiming amounts that were at odds mainly with their neighbours. People on this map, the markers are coloured according to how much someone claimed. The colour reflects the value, and we see that people tend to claim the same as their neighbours, more or less, and they're claiming more the further away they get from London. There are a couple of odd outliers in there. There's a little red dot right in the middle there, someone claiming a large amount. So these are MPs claiming significantly more than their neighbours, which is odd, possibly, and is, you know, something we would look at for a further question. But if we just sorted the data according to the amount that people had claimed, we might have missed those outliers. They might not have been, you know, in the top 10 of claims, but they are odd when compared to their neighbours. So how do you find out your neighbours? You want to make comparisons between data points that are neighbouring in some way, but what does neighbouring mean? Different definitions of neighbouring will give us different patterns of behaviour. Another way of looking at data, this is a network graph. This was generated using a tool called Gephi, and this shows the structure of followers of a particular Twitter account, where each of the dots, each of the names is a different Twitter Twitter ID, and I've grouped these Twitter IDs according to ones that follow each other. So Twitter IDs that follow each other or tend to follow each other are all grouped closely. And when we see this sort of network diagram, it's often referred to as a hairball. When we see the lines connecting the points, it can be hard to read. People think they just look like a mess. When we colour them appropriately and we lay them out according to spacing points so that people who connect to each other, people who follow each other are placed in similar locations, we start to get charts such as these that we can read of read as if they were maps. So we're all familiar with reading geographical maps. We can start to read these network diagrams themselves as maps, and different areas of the networks represent, in this case, Twitter people. It's people who share similar sorts of interests by virtue of following each other. So we can read these network diagrams as maps. Quite often when people see them, they just see them as sort of messes. But when we start to think of them in terms of geography and like things being close to like things, we can get a different sense of reading them. So finally, I've realized the time has moved on. I just wanted to talk about how we go about creating these charts. Now, again, writing 50 or so years ago, Tukey wrote, the hand drawing of graphs, except perhaps reproduction in books and in some journals, is now economically wasteful, slow, and on the way out. Tools were becoming available, computational tools were becoming available. Actually, this was written more recently than 50 years ago, in order to allow the creation of charts. So what sorts of tools allow us to do that? One of the tools that I use for generating charts and creating charts, different chart types on the fly, is the R statistical programming language, and a graphics library within that called ggplot. And what ggplot allows us to do is just take a data set, a data table, and using the idea of the grammar of graphics, I mentioned Lee Wilkinson right at the start of this presentation, it's a grammar for describing the construction of charts based on the claim that if we follow the grammar, we should not be able to create charts that don't make sense, so we should always be able to create meaningful charts. And the way we create charts is that we create a chart object, a ggplot chart object, and then we apply operations to the data within it. So in this, I've applied a whole variety of different operations to construct this chart. And this chart, we can read the construction of the chart. So I've started off by using something called a stat sum, which has summed up the, we've got a count of data points, and it's summing up the count of data points with a particular value. So I've got a set of values along the bottom D1, a set of values along the x, y-axis D2. I'm counting up the number that where we've got D1 equal to 0, number of D2 equals 15, counting those and then sizing a dot using a statistic called stat sum. These lines are linear regressions. So these are regressions based on the data points, and I've created that using a stat smooth. So stat smooth means that I want to create this smooth best fit line around these red data points. So this line is generated by data points at the top and a couple of data points down the bottom. I've got a couple of geom lines. So these are the red dotted line and the blue dotted line. They were each constructed by a separate line object. I've got another statistic, which is an AB line. The X equals Y line has been added to this chart. And there's a couple of other little dotted charts in there. So this chart has been written. It wasn't generated using wizards or drop-down menus. It was written. So it was written, it can be read visually, and we can also read the construction of it. This chart was created by executing the lines of code. And this chart is a novel chart type developed to try to make sense of these particular data sets. So I was trying to look about whether or not these data sets, the blue lines are meaningful, the red dashed line is meaningful, whether or not the distribution of points had a particular set of properties. So this was a tool constructed for me to help me read and understand this data set. Here's another tool. This tool, again, is showing a dot plot where with the size of the circles, accounts of the values of where the D1 and D2 values have taken a particular combination. So we've got a large number of things at this point, 5, 10, a large number at this point, which is 3, 9, a few, or just a singleton at the point 6, 15. And this chart was constructed again using ggplot, using this stat sum, this thing that counts up the number of occurrences of points at a particular XY value, and the data came from a query onto a database. And again, I've constructed the chart on a set of data that came from a query on a database. Again, this was all written, so it becomes reproducible. The data, we know where the data came from, we know how the data object was constructed, and then we know how the chart object was constructed. And I think one of the things that we need to start doing more of when we're working with data sets is producing these reproducible scripts that we can read as scripts, that we can read as analyses, and that are also constructive in the sense that they construct the data charts from the text. So we need ways of recording conversations. And just to finish off with, there's a couple of tools that I use for as environments for doing these sorts of reproducible analyses. One is a tool called RStudio, which is used for working with the R programming language. So the charts that were shown previously were generated with the R programming language. And we can write analyses within these environments, and we can generate PDF documents. We can generate documents that are prettily styled like this from within the environment. And another set of tools that I've been working with are called IPython notebooks. And this is a notebook style environment where we have separate cells, so different cells where we can write code, we can write text, we can execute code, and by executing the code, the results of executing the code are placed within the data set. So in this cell, I was doing a sorting operation on a data set. I executed that code, and it prints the output of my operation. I've written some text. Then I write the chart I want to draw. There's a lot of tools that allow us to build tools that are becoming increasingly easy to use. There's a lot of tools that are power tools that, if we take the time to learn how to use them, allow us to construct what we should. I think utility in moving towards models where we start to write charts and record the construction of charts and then generate those charts as tools when working with data of whatever sort. Again, apologies for the scattergun nature of that presentation. Hopefully there were odd little bits that were intriguing or useful to you. Everything I play with or explore ends up at some point or other on the Useful Info blog, so feel free to read there. Feel free to ask questions, comments on any of the posts that appear there, and feel free as well to challenge me, heckle me, hassle me, chase me to explain things in more detail or give you clues as to how to work with your own data on Twitter at Psychomedia.